This is the Tomi Maru number 85, a Japanese stern trawler fishing off the Fairweather ground in the Gulf of Alaska. These Japanese fishermen are working on their huge nets as they have for years, pulling in a rich harvest of pollock and Pacific Ocean perch as they have for years. But this year there's one big difference. This year they cannot fish here without a permit from the United States government, a permit which tells them what species of fish they can catch and how much and where. A permit which allows the United States Coast Guard and the National Marine Fisheries Service to board their ship at any time, as long as they're within 200 miles of the coast. This year, the Fisheries Conservation and Management Act, better known as the 200-mile limit, went into effect. Alaska Review traveled with the Coast Guard to observe boardings and talk to the people who are grappling with the complexities of this new law, a law which is the result of a bitter fight in the U.S. Congress and intense opposition from countries like Japan, who want to be free to fish or even overfish in waters off America for the protein they need so badly. Alaska Senator Ted Stevens played a key role in support of the 200-mile limit.
Well, you know, State Department didn't support this bill to start with, and the Department of Defense didn't. It took the president to turn him around and say, I'm going to keep the commitment I made in Anchorage, and I'm going to sign that bill. I really have a feeling that the fishing community is not totally aware of the tremendous importance of the president's change of mind right here in Anchorage. That brought about the decision. The law of the sea delegation was still opposed to the 200-mile bill. The Department of Defense was opposed to it. The Department of State was opposed to it. I think every department of the government was opposed to it, but the president said, I'm willing to try it.
The Fisheries Conservation and Management Act carved up U.S. fishing waters into eight regions, each one headed up by a management council. This is the North Pacific Council at one of its regular meetings in Anchorage. Because Alaska has over a third of the nation's coastline, the most foreign ships off that coastline, and the biggest fish harvest of any state, this council is the most powerful one in the United States. Its 11 voting members, a majority of them Alaskans, have the responsibility for drawing up management plans for fish, setting foreign fishing quotas accordingly, approving or disapproving permit applications from foreign fishing boats, and dictating the conditions of those permits. Elmer Rasmuson is chairman of the council.
The council, in applying that act, is giving every preference that it can to the expansion of this U.S. Fleet. And I think that as the fishing effort expands, partly due to a general increase in demand for fishery stocks, which are really very limited, and also improvement in our own techniques, I believe that the United States fishermen are gradually going to take over this, and that is an objective, I would say, of the council, to see one day that all of the fish that we can harvest. We can't be like a dog in a manger. We can't say that because we're not harvesting in it, nobody can do it. That's contrary to the law and contrary to the general international thinking on that subject. But we are going to further and push the domestic fishermen as fast as we can, as far as we can, into this catching process. And I would like to see someday that 100% of our fishery products caught within our 200-mile jurisdiction is caught by U.S. fishermen.
The council's underlying purpose is to promote American fishing. So they set quotas by subtracting what they figure Alaskans will catch of a given species from the maximum amount that can be fished and still keep that species going. Whatever is left over is allocated to the foreigners. But almost from the very start, the council ran into criticism over some of their quotas. Specifically, fishermen in Kodiak are enraged that for 1977, foreigners were allowed 12,500 metric tons of Tanner crab, with Alaskans getting 25,000 tons. A metric ton is 2,200 pounds. The Alaskans, and the processors, by the way, think that they should have gotten all of the crab with none for the foreigners. Tom Casey is head of the Kodiak Fishermen's Marketing Association.
It's action the council failed to take that really aggravates us. Number one, the Department of Commerce recommended the Japanese receive an additional 2,500 tons of Tanner crab on top of the 10,500 tons they were receiving anyway for 1977. Now, we thought this was totally inappropriate because we believe the crab stocks in that area are declining, which Dr. Lee Alverson of the National Marine Fisheries Service said they are at the last council meeting. And second of all, we believe the Americans have the boats and the processing facility on shore to harvest all those crab and market them successfully. So we think that there was a political decision made either in Washington, D.C. or in other spots around the United States in combination to give those crab to the Japanese so as to entice them to agree to our 200-mile limit. Now, that doesn't flush with us. That doesn't go over very well at all.
Alaska Review accompanied Troy Bowers, his crew, and his son Toby to check on a subsistence crab pot they maintain outside the Kodiak Harbor. Bowers uses his 38-foot boat, the Naiad, to catch shrimp and halibut in addition to king crab. King crab is now a completely American industry. Foreigners were banned from catching it a couple of years ago. People like Casey think that Tanner crab should go the same way as king crab, but the council, for its first year of operation, is relying on an interim plan drawn up not by them, but by the National Marine Fisheries Service, and they can't change things in midstream because the foreign permits have already been issued. Next year's permanent plan may very well give all the profitable large-sized Tanner crab to Alaskans, not necessarily because the fishermen want them, but because of the Alverson report that Casey referred to. That report says that the overall number of commercial-sized Tanner crab is going to take a tremendous drop to 1/6 of current levels in the next 5 years. Nonetheless, Tom Casey is afraid the council has set a precedent for ignoring the needs of Alaskan fishermen.
I also believe that the Alaska fishermen have to take the initiative. They have to push for the things that they want, and among them, I think, should be less bureaucrats on this North Pacific Council. By God, I feel like someone in a Franz Kafka play, going in to appeal to people who have no firm connection with the ups and downs in our business. They're bureaucrats, they're paid a salary and benefits and cost of living allowance, and regardless of what happens in a fishing port like Kodiak, they're going to make good money. We have a very hard time working with people like that.
Except for salmon and Tanner crab, there's really not too much competition between Americans and foreigners for specific kinds of fish. Alaskans have smaller boats that stay closer to shore. They concentrate on the high-priced products like king crab. An Alaskan fisherman is essentially a small businessman out to make a living for himself. The foreigners look at fishing as a big business. Their fishing boats are 150 feet long or more. They are fully equipped to travel thousands of miles on the high seas to reach the fishing grounds, and they process the fish on board. The Japanese rely on fish for their national survival. The average American consumes 12.9 pounds of fish per year. The average Japanese eats 40 pounds per year, or more than three times as much. The Japanese concentrate on ground fish, especially pollock. 90% of the fish caught within 200 miles of Alaska is caught by foreigners, and over half of that is the Japanese pollock harvest. These men are preparing the gear on a Japanese longliner. They take 75 meters of line with a hook every 5 feet or so and coil it onto round mats called skates. They bait each hook and mount them on the edge of the skate. Then they pay out the line through a hole in the back of the ship, tying each length together until there are 17 miles of line in the water. It takes 12 to 14 hours to do this. It also takes 12 to 14 hours to bring the gear and the fish back on board. This ship, the Riojo Maru number 17, was catching black cod, the large dark fish, and rock-eye ground fish, the ugly pink ones. American fishermen would like to break into the ground fish market, but it's tough. The fish is cheap, only 6 cents a pound for pollock, and it takes multi-million dollar boats, such as the Japanese have, to catch the huge volume of fish necessary to make a profit. So this year, the foreigners got a huge quota for pollock, 149,000 tons, and Alaskans got almost none, only 1,000 tons. To be allowed more, the Americans are faced with a strange catch-22 situation. They have to catch more to prove that they can be allowed to catch more. Once again, the council has been caught in the bind of its own quota. One recent proposal would have gotten around all this. allow American fishermen to catch pollock and deliver it to Korean factory ships on the high seas. But the council rejected the plan, saying it could hurt shore-based processors and might constitute overfishing. The council hopes to resolve the whole groundfish problem by the first of next year. But for now, the foreigners still take most of the groundfish under the watchful eye of the United States Coast Guard.
Lower the boat!
Alaska Review traveled from Juneau to Kodiak on the 378-foot Coast Guard cutter Boutwell and observed three boardings. A special agent for the National Marine Fisheries Service leads the search of the ship. In our case, the agent was Ed Wickersham, a man in civilian clothes.
You check the fish bins and the holds where the bulk of the fish are being kept to see that they are, in fact, what they are catching, what the percentages are. Again, just to corroborate what they're telling us. Then all the other general commercial spaces or the general areas where the fishermen carry on the work of the ship, the gear lockers, the bosun stores areas, things like this, all these are checked to see that they aren't taking minor amounts of prohibited species. Maybe we've been on ships where you'll find two or three crabs tucked away someplace, a salmon stuck up above an overhead, you know, things like this. Well, this certainly isn't as serious as someone taking hundreds of tons, but it is prohibited, and we want to see, just like we would with an American fisherman, that they are, in fact, abiding by the law. Well, there was, in a case of a foreign vessel that was boarded under the old Continental Shelf Fisheries Resource Act, when the people began to inspect the holds, they found an area where a false bulkhead had been put up in the hold, which was very irregular. This is not normally the case, and literally tons of halibut were put in this area and then were being covered up with the normal catch. And if the inspection hadn't been made when it was, and maybe a few more tons of fish had been added, it would have been almost impossible to determine that that halibut was on board. And there was no record of the halibut in any of the normal logs we would inspect.
You found anything
unusual? No, everything's fine.
Looks so what, good. What are you going to do now?
Well, we're going to go and talk to the captain, tell him it looks okay, and ask him a few questions.
Okay.
Is he catching anything other than black cod?
No, he says whatever he catches in those long lines, he throws right back.
Okay, how about halibut? Are they taking any halibut? Occasionally, and they know they're supposed to return those to the sea immediately. Ask him if he has seen any Korean vessels. South Korea.
そうですね。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方に。北の方 Oh, 100 kilometers, huh?
158 north.
Okay, fine. Tell him thank you.
This is the third Japanese ship that we've boarded in the last 2 days. And the record on this ship, as well as all the others, was they're clean. They're obeying the law.
Water, 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 water.
Wickersham is referred to as a fish cop. In that sense, the Coast Guard can be considered the patrol car of the high seas. The men on board the Boutwell maintain a constant watch for foreign ships. When a blip is spotted on the radar screen, an intercept course is plotted. If it turns out to be a foreign vessel, flags are raised and the boarding party gets ready. The Boutwell is equipped with a 5-inch gun, which is more symbolic than anything else. It's the holstered gun of the cop on the street, the badge of authority. Another feature of the Boutwell is her speed. In addition to two diesel engines, she has two turbine engines that can power the screws. These turbines are modifications of the jet engines of a Boeing 707 airplane. They can push the 3,080-ton Boutwell at an astounding 27 knots. Foreign fishing vessels simply cannot outrun her. The captain of the Boutwell is Richard T. Brower.
About how many of these boardings do you expect to make in your Alaskan tour?
Well, it all depends on this trip, just how many vessels that we find and the vessels that we're after. I would estimate that probably between 20 and 25 in the 60 days that we'll be up here. It's very dependent on the weather. We'll have many days that it's just impossible to board. It's too dangerous to put the boat in the water and to have the men go over the side.
What's your strategy in locating ships?
Probably 4 days out of seven we will be on radio silence. Most of the fleets up here will maintain a guard on the Coast Guard frequencies that they know we're on, and they know where we are and when to expect us. This way we at least have a little bit of subterfuge in trying to find them.
I'm right to 000.
Right 15 degrees rudder.
Right full rudder.
Right full rudder.
Right full rudder, sir.
Senator Stevens has only one complaint with the Coast Guard's enforcement. He wishes the State Department wouldn't meddle in their affairs.
It led to a decision in several instances where a foreign fishing vessel was not apprehended because of other considerations. Once when Mr. Vance was in, Secretary Vance was in Moscow, another time when we were in some very touching negotiations apparently with Japan, and well, I must say that foreign policy considerations enter into the matter. They should not enter into it at the time the law enforcement officer has to make the decision to seize. And the reason is this, that if that Coast Guard commander is overruled from Washington and told to ignore the violation because there are other overriding considerations, it's going to deter him. It's going to be a disappointing thing. He may not be as zealous in enforcing the law the next time, particularly if it means any kind of risk to himself or his vessel or his crew to enforce the law.
But except for that, and the complaints some fishermen have about two of the council's actions which will probably be remedied within 6 months, the Fisheries Conservation and Management Act seems to be working well. The foreigners now have to apply for permits. Permits which can be revoked, so they are obeying the law, at least so far. But no matter how well the foreigners behave, they know their days in Alaskan waters are numbered. And that's what the 200-mile limit is all about.
As of March 1st, who benefited more, the foreigners or the Americans?
Well, I see this whole law and its implementation as something like a 15-round heavyweight bout. I think that if you record the first round on March 1, they floored us. They knocked us down and the foreigners won the first round. They had people in Washington, D.C. from their governments applying enormous pressure to our government people to be easy on them, the Japanese and the Russians, and they succeeded. So let's give the first two rounds to them. I think that we're battling back now in the middle rounds, and my confidence is that by the 15th, we'll be on top with the decision.
And that means that eventually there will be no foreigners fishing within 200 miles of Alaska.
I believe that within my lifetime, probably before I see 45 years old. I'm 27 right now. I bet before I see 45, there won't be a foreign boat on the ocean.
And you'll be perfectly happy with that situation.
I'll be very happy. It'll mean a lot of employment, it'll mean a lot of jobs, a lot of savings, it'll mean a lot of prosperity for coastal towns in Alaska. I look forward to the day with relish.
A look at the tanker trials in Valdez when Alaska Review continues.